discussion, he had asked, what is Islam's position on homosexuality?
Okay, that question also was answered very nicely yesterday by Imam Zayd Shaker, and I share his views, and I've spoken about that also freely. You see, there is a difference between somebody having a feeling or inclination as such, which may not be, you may agree or disagree with it, and between acting on that in something that is, to us, is unethical or unacceptable. So whenever people ask me about that question, I said, look, to me as a Muslim, based on the authentic sources that I accept as revelation from the Creator who knows everything and has that wisdom, infinite wisdom, I do not consider that acceptable to me as a Muslim. And the Quran speaks about it, and by the way, the Bible also speaks about Sodom and Gomorrah in that sense. But you have to hasten also by saying, I have no right as a Muslim to push my moral convictions myself on anyone else in this society. Given the society, the open, liberal, secular society we live in, I have no right to force my belief on anyone. In fact, I have no right to force my belief on anyone even in any other society. This is my conviction. I have the right to that conviction as much as a homosexual might have the right to accept whatever conviction he or she believes in. It's to me, I'm not forcing it. Secondly, you have to keep in mind the audience that you're addressing. Because oftentimes, when people speak against this, even from the moral perspective, they use very inflammatory type of term, like saying, this is sinful, this is this, this. Just put it in a neutral form. To me, it means this way. You have to realize that people asking this question also, they have a background of that those who reject accepting homosexuals or homosexuality as totally normal and should be, you know, equated with any other sexual orientation, they believe that those people in fact are bigots and they are calling for aggression against those people or discrimination. So it is very important to say, and to say it truthfully, not as a political, politically correct statement, that as a Muslim, in the context of society we're living, I am against any act of violence committed against people who chose that way of life, or discrimination against them, also in a way that is not fair and contrary to the laws of the land. And then you might end again with the repetition, emphasizing again, that this is my conviction as a Muslim. I'm not calling for violence against anyone, and I'm not pushing that down the throat of anyone else.
Jazakallahu khair for that answer. A couple months ago, I was rereading this one book that I really like by Walter Kaufman. It's called The Critique of Religion and Philosophy, in which he criticizes and points out the shortcomings of religion. And also those who criticize religion, the secularist or the atheistic point of views. And in that book, and also in general, if you speak to atheists in general, they have issues with human suffering. They have a big issue with human suffering. So if you are talking with atheists, almost always you would get this question that we receive very often. One of the questions was, if God is so just, why is there so much suffering in this world?
Okay, we have to be straightforward, non-apologetic, when it comes to matters of fundamental beliefs. I know that some people would say, make all kind of argument that if we don't know suffering, then we cannot appreciate health. If there is no sick, the opposites. We don't know anything except if you know the opposite of it. But opening that door would say, all right, but why you have to have to have people suffer as a price so that we can appreciate health. So you're really in a circle that is almost never ending. You know what is the most clear ayah in the Quran that comes to mind when this type of question? The qadr, the predestination. Why there is suffering? Or in a similar way, so that we save time also, why there is the problem, there are disasters, tsunamis, and all of these. The direct answer in the Quran is this. لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. We have to start from the basic belief, which means Allah is not to be questioned as to what He does, but it is we who are to be questioned as to what we are doing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the supreme creator. and to try to discern his wisdom, we can only go that far. And we are required to try to understand the wisdom of Allah. That's why the fuqaha speak about illa, you know, what is the effective reason for this rule or that. That's fine. But above all, when it comes to in a matter of ghaib or unbelief, the unseen, we have to defer to the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the things that attracted my attention is amazing, that the first ayat revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of the order, historical order of revelation, are the ones in Surah Al-Alaq. We all know it. It speaks about knowledge, searching, using the pen, mentioning twice. And then you find a lot of other ayat in the Quran and hadith urging us to think logically, to understand, to use this gift of Allah of thinking and understanding and feeling and experimentation to discern His word. But in the order of the Quran, as given to the Prophet ﷺ, in the way the Mus'haf is ordered, immediately after the introduction to the Quran, I consider Al-Fatiha just like an introduction to the Quran, praising Allah as you begin to read in this book, to seek guidance, seeking the guidance of Allah, you know, straight path. So you're almost like praying first, Ya Allah, show me the guidance as I read that Quran. The answer to your dua of Al-Fatiha is immediately coming in the next surah, Al-Baqarah. If you're seeking guidance, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ. It is in this book there is no doubt about it. But then the surah continues to describe the traits or characteristics of believers. And you know what is number one? أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in the unseen. It didn't say those who believe in self-contradictory statements. It didn't say those who believe in something that can you definitely prove it is false, like 1 + 1 is equal to 27¾, for example. Don't tell me that's a myth. Be humble. This is ghaib. This is not ghaib. This is self-contradiction created by the human mind. So if you can prove definitively that something indeed is wrong, like 1 + 1, then don't tell me that's ghaib. That's not what the Quran refers to. If you can't, like the existence of Allah, you can make the best possible argument, and there are lots of good arguments in the Quran about the existence of Allah. In the mind of a skeptic, for every argument, he will find a counter argument. Even it may sound ridiculous, excess, unreasonable. Can you really prove to a person with that mentality, definitively, that Allah exists? I'm not saying that there's no argument. Can you prove it in a way that nobody can reject it, even the skeptic? No, you can't. But by the same token, can an atheist prove to you in a definitive, experimental way, as he wants just physical evidence, that Allah does not exist? Using his own logic, you can't. So ghaib then means something that you could not definitively prove or disprove, right? But you accept it because there is this inner call inside you. Of course, the atheist would not accept. The fitrah, the pure innate nature symbolized in Allah breathing something of His spirit, of course, not incarnationally, into every human being. That I could say, right. So I believe in Allah. It's not because scientists can give me evidence alone. It is also the inner call within me. So by the same token, when we deal with this ayah and the fact that it is mentioned right after Al-Fatiha, it meaning as you start reading this book, yes, remember what was revealed first to your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of using your mind. But mind has its own scope. But as you read this book, you will find something that you may not be able to fully understand. You may find some issues like Qadr, and Ghazali himself speak about Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, about the contradiction and problem people fall into when they try to explain the, predestination in human terms. That is beyond us, so we should know our limits as human. It is in that sense, then, that I can say that when we speak about the justice of God, we cannot define for Allah our understanding of justice, because we don't know everything about this universe. We don't even fully understand the physical existence of species that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, let alone something that can transcend our human life. And by the way, even from the so-called